Briefly, my name is Derek Brose. I'm 33 years old. I'm from Houston, Texas. I've been an activist, journalist, investigative journalist, radio show host, all these kind of different labels. But I've been doing it for about 9 years, starting with activism in 2010 in Houston, where I'm from. And, you know, started a community called the Houston Freethinkers about 2010. And then around the time the Occupy movement launched, we worked a lot together, the Houston Freethinkers and Occupy Houston, did a lot of different community initiatives, as well as protests and rallies and all that sort of thing. I spent, you know, my first couple years doing that, sort of doing everything from cop watching to community garden stuff to I'm also a promoter, so we work a lot with musicians, as you can see on this tour. So booking like benefit shows to raise money against, you know, the drug war for survivors of human trafficking, you know, really whatever kind of issue that our community was concerned about that month, we would say, okay, we're going to host a documentary about that topic. Let's, you know, find a documentary that we think we want to host and share with people. Let's go out to the streets and pass out information about whatever that topic is. Let's host the benefit show to raise, you know, funds for individuals or organizations who are working on those causes. And that was kind of our whole beginning. And over the last 8 years, it's really just evolved into this beautiful thing that's kind of consumed my life. Went from being like, okay, I'm kind of waking up to some injustices in the world and I'm becoming an activist, to being like, this is what I do full-time, 24/7. Now it's kind of consumed my life in the best way. It's the only thing to me that it feels valuable, feels worthy, and what I mean by that is it's working on myself as well as trying to work with other awesome people around the country and around the world who are trying to find solutions to the many ills that we have in the world. And so that's where my activism started. I started blogging a lot for the Houston Freethinkers website around 2012, 2013, a few different people, and the, you know, kind of burgeoning independent media, social media driven independent media reached out and said, hey, we can pay you for what you're doing, you know, you can get paid for the writing you're doing. And so I kind of started out just as like a side gig that I was doing. I was also building gardens for people in Houston, and then over the last 5 years or so that I've got into journalism, just, you know, through my curiosity, through my desire for research and understanding the world, it's become what I do full time. So I write for several independent media websites. That's how I feed myself and pay my bills and all that good stuff. And when I'm not writing articles or doing video content for my YouTube channel or for various other, you know, networks that I work with, I'm involved in Houston's community. As I said, the Houston Freethinkers, we've had three versions of the Freethinker House, which I actually just recently moved out of. But it's kind of like this. It's a space, though, where we can have events and have community. And so it was me and three other guys. We lived in different houses where we had, you know, a big yard where we could do community garden work, where we could host our shows, we could host documentary screenings, basically do all the stuff we were doing, but in our space, you know, and do it the way we want to do, after working with venues and different people for years. So yeah, I've been doing that now going on 8 years, and getting into activism, then that leading to journalism, that leading to just kind of being what I do full time. And then along the way, various people wanting to hear some of the ideas that I have as far as how we can decentralize, how we can localize and opt out of the various systems and institutions that don't serve the health and the wealth of our communities, be that governmental or corporate institutions and other organizations that we're going to talk about tonight. Along the way, I've also authored 4 books. We have 3 of them here tonight. They're also all available for free online. So, you know, I'm not here to be, this isn't just like I'm here to sell you books. The information is available for free online, and if you want a physical copy, we have those as well. My books go much more into detail into what my website's theconsciousresistance.com, the YouTube's The Conscious Resistance. That's kind of, I guess you could say, our movement in a sense that we're building. And what I mean by that, whenever that term came to me in 2013, after I'd been spending the first couple years of my activism kind of living 2 different lives, what I mean by that is I've always been interested in things like meditation, like we were doing earlier, and I've always been interested in kind of developing my consciousness. It really has blossomed a lot in the last decade, but I've always had those interests. And so in Houston, I had friends who I hung out. We went to spiritual gatherings and consciousness events and meditations and things like that. And then I had my activist friends. We went to protests and rallies and organizing meetings and things of that sort. But they very rarely kind of crossed over. And in fact, at this point, this was, you know, 2010, 12, 2011, 2012, I found like they were sort of almost diametrically opposed to each other. At least people thought so. So I would be with my activist friends, right? And we'd be at a rally or we'd be somewhere, and I'd maybe say, hey guys, anybody want to go, you know, participate in a meditation or some event I'm doing? Or maybe I'd say something trippy like, you know, maybe we're all God and we're just reflecting each other, you know, something trippy. And they're like, are you high? And I would say, I am, but that has nothing to do with what we're talking about here. You know, my point was they would be kind of very closed off to sort of spiritual, maybe esoteric, or just personal development work. It was more like just focused on, like, we need to protest, we need to, you know, face down the physical institutions of power. Then I would go to my spiritual groups and my kind of meditation circles, and I would say, hey, have you guys seen this police state? Have you seen all the, you know, the things they're doing to the environment and all this? And they would be like, don't talk about it. Don't talk about it. You're going to manifest it. You know, just this sort of mentality that we can just meditate things away. Like, obviously, I believe in the power of meditation, but alone, it's not going to solve the problem, right? So I kept finding myself in the situation. I was like, all right, I guess I'll just live these two different worlds. And then 2013 rolled around, and I had kind of another download, I guess is a way to put it, and this phrase, the conscious resistance, came to me. And what I mean by that, the conscious resistance, to me, this is the moment, the realization, or the recognition that the struggle for a more free, ethical, and just world is not going to come by only confronting the physical institutions of power, or by only working on our, you know, spiritual kind of personal self, that it has to be kind of, they're two sides of the same coin. This is, to me, they go hand in hand. You know, if we can create all the solutions we think might work in the economic system, the, you know, governmental system, organization, you know, ideas on all the different problems that we're going to go through, right? We can come up with the best solutions possible. We can start implementing them. Maybe a movement grows and they spread everywhere, right? But if each of us as individuals have not worked on our own inner shit, our inner, you know, conflict, what I call the internal tyrant, you know, which are our doubts, fears, and insecurities that each of us have, no matter how big any of us think we are, how we act on the internet or project ourselves outwardly, we're all the same, right? We all have doubts, fears, and insecurities. They may show themselves in different ways and express themselves in different ways. And sometimes you see somebody's insecurities and you're like, wow, that's so crazy to me. You know, that just seems silly for you to be worried about that. But again, things affect us differently, right? But until we learn and choose to deal with those things and go to the root of our various trauma and focus on healing and personal development, and that kind of on an individual sense as well as a communal sense, I don't think those solutions will actually take hold. Like, maybe we start implementing some of the ideas that I'm really excited about that I'll share in just a bit, but I truly believe if it does not happen at the same time as this kind of conscious evolution, for lack of a better term, then it'll only be a matter of time before we cycle back and become basically the people that we're fighting. You know, you look at the history of every single revolution that has happened, and most of the time, I mean, I'd say 90% of the time, the people become the thing that they were fighting. You know, they, you know, and obviously revolutions, evolutions, things like this are kind of a tumultuous time, right? But at the end of the day, if we become the people that we're fighting, then I think we're only working against ourselves, right? And also, I'm personally not really interested in a revolution in the sense of some kind of violent uprising, or really even that term, because when you break down the term and you think about revolution, right, it implies revolving, going in circles, right? I want to step out of the circle. I want to take, you know, step to the next stage of humanity. And as maybe that cliche or kind of idealistic that sounds, that's truly why I'm doing the things that I do and why I dedicate my time to the books and talks and YouTube videos and journalism, all that stuff. It's all geared towards trying to wake people up to a lot of different things and issues, as well as I learn. You know, I'm not here to speak and claim to have all the answers, right? But so that's what I've been doing now for the last 8 years. And before I get now into the tour, there's one last personal thing that I'd like to share that I think will kind of emphasize why I emphasize the need for healing. So I mentioned that my kind of political activist awakening started in about 2010, but I personally feel like my kind of more personal, maybe more important or more vital awakening or kind of awareness came in about 2005. In 2005, November 2005, I was arrested for possession of crystal meth. I'd been addicted to crystal for about 10 months, and then I got locked up in Texas state institutions, first time for a year. Then I went back, you know, I ended up doing about 18 months between November 2005 and October 2008, back and forth a couple of times. And the preceding months before my arrest, I was basically like January 2005. It was the first time I tried crystal. Within like 10, 11 months, I was, you know, I lost my apartment, lost my relationship, like lost my job, was homeless, was living on the streets, was living in a crack house, just got totally sucked into this whole other world, was, you know, doing some running for some big time career drug dealers who had no interest in changing their lives, and I just kind of got sucked into this thing, and then I got locked up, and thankfully though I was able to get myself sober before I got locked up, but I continued to deal, and so I ended up getting pulled over one day. And that was a chance, though. Getting locked up was a chance for me personally to do a lot of self-reflection. That's actually where I first started meditating, was in prison. I was there, and they have in Houston, they have the Saturday section of the paper. They have a religious section, and you know, it's all kinds of different articles, but there's a section where they quote like the Bible, the Quran, the Torah, and then they had a quote from the Dhammapada, which is sometimes known as the Buddhist Bible. It's a collection of verses from the Buddha. And I don't remember which one I read, but something I read just immediately struck me, and was like, I need to know more about this. So I sent my girlfriend and my grandma, like, hey, can you send me chapters of the Dhammapada, or, you know, send me books on that. And so I started getting books about meditation while I was locked up, and really just started journaling every day and doing a lot of self-reflection to ask myself, like, why the hell did I get here? And for me, you know, I was very, very, very much like trying to get the lessons I needed, because I've grown up in a family of at least three generations going back, and the men on the bro's side of my family, my father's side, have drug abuse, alcohol abuse, and prison. Like, my great-grandfather hung himself in prison. He had abused my grandpa had abused my dad, got him using drugs by the time he was 8 years old, and then my dad has been addicted to drugs for his entire life. And actually, just to be real, I actually just found out he died yesterday from a drug overdose. So it's something that's very like present in my life. And so when I found myself being arrested, it was like, you know, I spent my whole life angry at this dude and having to visit him in prison and all this kind of stuff. And then also that contributed to the depression and a lot of the, I'd attempted to kill myself several times as a young adult. And those were the root causes of why, by the time I got out of high school and then somebody offered me, you know, ecstasy or some drug, I was like, holy crap, I feel amazing. This is all I needed. This will heal my depression and all my problems I have inside, right? But obviously, I was truly just kind of self-medicating. I was covering up the shit that I didn't want to deal with, and I didn't really have the tools to yet, you know? And it just got progressively worse till one day I tried crystalline, and that was it. It just grabbed me, and then I found myself locked up. So I really had to do a lot of self-reflection of asking myself, like, do I want to continue down this, you know, family tradition, or do I want to try to do something different? And obviously I've chose a different path. And once again, not here to act as if I've got all the answers, but I put a lot of time into self-reflection and working on myself. And it's an ongoing process, right? That's life is a journey, right? We're never going to get to this point of perfection. But we work to being better and empowering ourselves. And so although my message is very much one of how can we organize on the local level and use various tools to opt out of the systems economically, you know, and et cetera, other ways. But also it's of this, how can we empower ourselves? How can we enrich ourselves and get everyone to recognize that we are each free, powerful, beautiful people, capable of so much, capable of, with full of potential. And again, I don't mean that in any cliche way. I truly believe that once we recognize our power and we step up to the plate, so to speak, we're going to be ready to change the world, but it's going to take us working on ourselves in addition to trying to seek new systems that actually represent what we want. So, yeah, that's a bit of background on me, and I'd like to tell you about the tour now and then.